Super.
Great. Over to you guys. Thanks.
Thank you so much. So I'm not sure I'm going to be able to see the chat box with my presentation on, but I'll obviously we'll address the questions at the end. And we've got online Shane and Kiara. So Kiara is joining from the doctor's waiting room in Nairobi. So she may not be on for very long. Unfortunately, Kiara works for DRC. They're newly appointed, in fact, Global Shelter and Settlement Sector Lead. And Shane is joining us from Hong Kong. So thanks so much to Shane because it's so late, where he's acting as an independent consultant in shelter and settlements as an engineer with previous engagement with many agencies. I think he knows a lot of you online today. And we've come together under the mantle of one of the working groups of the Global Shelter Cluster to address construction good practice standards, which I will be presenting on today. So what are the construction good practice standards? I'm not sure how many of you have heard about them before, so we'll just give a basic update on where we've got to with this and what they are. The standards are a commonly agreed baseline of good practice for the management of construction in both humanitarian and development programming. And the idea is to provide informed standards for the various stages of the complex construction processes. It's come out of a misunderstanding of those standards. And certainly the need for intervention at every stage of the project cycle. And under the same, I'm quoting here quite a lot, because I really do feel that the site management standards were so amazing, particularly where you say they do apply to all contexts. And in the same way, construction good practice standards should be applicable to all contexts as well as all sectoral responses. So while we've seen this initiative being driven and generously supported by the shelter cluster, what we're trying to do is engage all sectors in understanding the requirement for safe construction, particularly as we see higher risk construction activities and infrastructure being done in some of our other sectors, such as education and health. And obviously under the camp management structure, you have a safety action plan that should define safety standards within the the site and the ability to also define safe construction activities. And also, I'm going to quote Phil here because I really thought this was so important in his opening remarks last week, was that the standards seek to address something fundamental, the issue of professionalization in the humanitarian sector. And I know that, a lot of this will ring true to a lot of you here today, but I feel that, we do so much good work as good people, in our humanitarian way, but we don't necessarily do it safely or with a huge amount of accountability. And we've certainly been known to make a lot of mistakes. And I think part of the problem is we need to apply a private sector professionalization view to the work that we do in emergency contexts, and accept that it's not okay just to do a kind of okay job under an emergency context when that okay job could potentially injure or kill. So in the same way that the camp management standards, I keep referring to them because I just love it, they are not construction good practice standards are not how to do construction. Really important, this is not a construction manual, but it is a description of good practices to ensure safe and quality construction. And who are they for? Obviously the implementing agencies who are directly constructing in camps and obviously outside of camps, but they will use this to inform their projects. We've seen a great amount of donor engagement in supporting the reference of the standards to ensure that planning, budget, and design requirements are within program delivery and accountability. And of course, as I mentioned, that all sector responses, we would seek to have all clusters using the standards to ensure inter-agency partners apply these equitable approaches towards accountability, safety, and quality. So the goals of the construction good practice standards, obviously safe construction, accountability, as I mentioned, through better planning, design, and construction. Very important, the effectiveness of donor money. And I again, to another presentation we've had today, which I thought was brilliant, was Kelly's presentation on the life cycle analysis. And I'm so excited about that tool because I actually feel we can apply not only effectiveness in the way that money is spent, but also effectiveness in the way that decisions are made around our environmental impact. So this is a really, really, we do have a very strong link to environmental impact in the construction good practice standards. And I think it will be supported by this SMAC tool. We'd also seek to ensure, as I say, sustainability of the buildings, but also maintenance needs to be mainstreamed. I think this is a commonly accepted gap area in our field and certainly within Save the Children, where we strive to ensure that not only is the delivery of the building considered, but also the long-term maintenance. and engage stakeholders at level. And also looking at the universal adoption of the standards by, as I said, implementing agencies and organizations to establish an appropriate expectation of implementation. And the reason for that, of course, is we work in such varied contexts with such varied regulatory environments, where we know that in many cases, those regulatory environments are inadequate to cope with the growing awareness and needs of disaster risk reduction and enhanced resilience of the infrastructure in this, the spaces where we work. So obviously, where do the standards apply? So obviously, the standards are applicable to any construction project in humanitarian and development contexts. And why we say this, of course, is and I'll go back to the camp minimum standards for camp management because I love them, but I love this. It's a voluntary code for quality and accountability designed to encourage possible use and ownership of the standards. And very importantly, because everybody always gets caught up on this topic, is that conforming to the standards does not mean implementing all key actions or meeting all key indicators of all standards. The degree to which an organization can meet the standards will depend on a range of factors, some of which are beyond their control. And I really love that because I think half of the time people see a standard and they think, well, it's something that we cannot seek to achieve. But if you can seek to achieve one aspect of your standards, and with every incremental project, you can improve on the next one, we can start to see things like quality and safety management being improved in some of our more complex scenarios. And they can begin, instead of being something new that you're applying to your programming, it becomes mainstreamed. And then you can seek to achieve the next standard and the next standard and the next. And I can certainly say anecdotally from Save the Children, we've been applying this our own internal standards for construction best practice in multiple countries around the world. We have more than 28 countries that are currently running construction project improvement plans and really seen the most amazing amount of uptake. And particular wins have been around safety on site, safety of buildings, quality of construction and resilience of the building going forward under sequential disaster issues. So it really is a place where people can certainly seek to achieve some improvements. And for you, Jennifer, I will then go in to tell you why it's relevant or where it's most relevant within your camp management standards. Particularly going back to those standards under three, the safe environment, particularly around site planning and physical infrastructure. And I mean, just thinking about the anecdote we mentioned about fencing in fire safety is one aspect. If you think about emergency evacuation procedures for any disaster within an infrastructure site, but obviously if we were to have flooding or other issues, ensuring that there is an appropriate safe environment for the construction of those four walls.
No, I can't.
Hi, Charles. Did you have something to say? Chuck? Nope. Okay. design maintenance and improvement plans of site facilities and infrastructure, that again is alluded to within the camp management standards or the site management agency standards. And obviously the high risk activities of retrofitting or improving site facilities. Again, as mentioned, environmental impact is so critical and really can be supported through construction standards, where we have a number of, I'll show you the summary page in a minute. A number of key recommendations for that. And as I mentioned, the multiple or sequential disasters that can occur over the, what is it, average, used to be average 17 years lifespan of a refugee. I think that's gone up now. So we cannot assume, of course, that within that time, there isn't going to be a need for retrofitting improvements or possibly ensuring that buildings are resilient to begin with. And then, of course, there's the public services that fall under the mandate of the coordination for public services within the camps, ensuring that you have skilled staff for the effective program design, and particular in construction for technical supervision and monitoring. And then, as I've mentioned already, the safety aspects, the protection aspects, the dignity aspects. And it's so interesting also how these things come about. We were talking, in fact, it's been one of the standards to ensure that there's internal partitions that can provide safety and protection for refugees, depending on context. And so important that sort of thing is considered under the processes for refugees in camp management. Essential services, and then as as was quite nicely highlighted by Jim, and I think it's a great overarching context, is this notion of what is the camp closure going to be around that infrastructure, particularly decommissioning latrines, which is often, very often not done. And you've created a death trap there with those pits. And of course, the environmental impacts around land rehabilitation. I think Chuck, can somebody tell Chuck to mute? I don't know if he knows he's chatting. And so to come to the summary page, I'm going to hand over to Shane Kopp, who's calling in from Hong Kong. Thanks, Shane.
Yeah, hi. So I just want to talk a little bit about the kind of basic run through of the standards. And then later we'll talk a little bit about kind of real world examples and how this actually applies to CCCM. So first, as you can see here, the is my camera on? I don't think it is. Okay. Technical issue, no problem. So you can see here, basically it starts from proposal all the way to the end of handover and maintenance. So it's a start to finish. The CGPS is not just for design, it's not just for the construction phase. It's for basically the birth of the project up to while they're maintaining the project. Currently, we don't have decommissioning, which would be, you know, way further down the line, but that's something that we're thinking about in the future. So with CCCM, the most applicable here would be definitely project proposal development, project planning, some design, some procurement, some construction, and definitely some handover maintenance. So as Liz was saying, there's still a lot of aspects of this that apply to CCCM, which, you know, on the surface, the construction good practices, you might not think might be too CCCM applicable. So Liz, can we hit the next slide, please? Okay, thank you. So why do we need them? So the first thing we say here is the humanity sector has a poor record in construction of in quality and in delivery. I can't stress this enough. So the real world example I want to give for that is in Haiti. It doesn't take an engineer to know or to see that when you're looking around in Haiti after the earthquake and people are rebuilding using the exact same methods and the exact same materials as were done before, you know, the stuff that fell down, how is that building back better? How is that building back safer? That building back exactly the same or maybe not even quite as good. So, you know, there's definitely issues with, you know, as we talked earlier about professionals in the sector, where it's, you know, throw that in good enough, you know, good enough for Haiti, good enough for whatever. In many places, existing codes aren't adequate or not enforced. And perfect example is Haiti. You know, before the earthquake, codes weren't enforced. That's why most of Port-au-Prince fell down, because, you know, people just built however the cheapest way they could. After the earthquake, this, you know, we saw the same pattern. You know, organizations were building exactly the same way. Definitely not to code, definitely without engineering guidance. You know, this is a problem within our sector. And overall, construction is a very high risk activity. And so it's a lot of money. They're expensive and they're high risk. And the level of professionalism that paid to them and the level of risk management in terms of design, in terms of planning, isn't being applied. And that's something that we're aiming to change here. So I want to talk a little bit about some real world examples. There's a lot of people on this call I can see from that have worked in Cox's Bazaar or currently are in Cox's Bazaar. And that's a perfect example. So some of the failures we had in Cox's Bazaar in terms of this that possibly could have been fixed, you know, with the CGBS brought in, the main one I'd want to bring up is cut and fill. Cut and fill was brought up very early on in the response and basically was turned down. It was too expensive. The people that made the decisions weren't really sure about it. They didn't necessarily understand it. The money wasn't there for it. The planning wasn't there for it. And the understanding of what happened. There were no, you know, high level consulting engineers embedded as decision makers so that they could say, oh, yes, that's a really great idea. We need to pursue that. So that's something that with the construction good practice standards, we can say, okay, we need, you know, to have construction people embedded in certain positions. We need to have amount of money for, you know, construction people, engineers, architects, to look at particular things in advance, to give their ideas, you know, early on. Now, that's not to say there weren't any successes. There were multiple successes in Cox's Bazaar. So bamboo is a great success. So one of the bamboo success stories is just the initial design and planning of the shelters. The spacing of the joists, basically the beams in the shelters, the spacing of the columns, all of that was engineered to a degree. Cross bracing, also, you know, engineered the connections, you know, also engineered and, you know, brought into the IAC materials. So that's a success. And that's where design comes in a CCM setting to improve it. Now, do these meet, you know, a building code? Absolutely not. Are they going to last longer because of these, you know, very low cost or no cost improvements? Absolutely. So, and another one that this is a success that happened later on is the treatment of bamboo. The they're using a borate treatment for the bamboo so that the bamboo doesn't rot as long, rot as quickly, excuse me. Bangalore is very hot, humid. A lot of the bamboo is driven into the ground, so rotting can happen in easily 6 months, no problem at all. So with the treatment, this extends the life of the bamboo and therefore extends the life cycle of the shelter project. This was a development brought in by Sebastian Kaminsky from Arup. He came in and did some presentations, and you know, and that made a lot of sense, and that people jumped on that. Other success stories: for the Army Road, there's a road that runs right up the middle of the camp, basically the spine of the camp. The large drainage culverts that were, you know, designed and installed. That's a product of complicated engineering analysis and engineering design. And so that was a success because that was engineering design brought in to help minimize flooding and help minimize roads washing out so that CCM services can be provided more easily. As you can see from the bottom of the slide here, when should they be used? The CGPS, and basically at every stage. Now, the key is that we don't just, you know, read the document at every stage. Donor endorsement and donor money at every stage is also important because construction activities are expensive, and they need to be supported, and the risk needs to be managed properly, either through, you know, good engineering, good, you know, other good risk management practices, health and safety standards being implemented, whatever it takes to make the project work better. And now I'm going to pass you off to Liz, and Liz is going to continue.
Great. So, thanks so much, Shane. So just to give you a heads up on where we've got to in terms of the activities that we're doing. So under the Global Shelter Cluster, the working group is now transitioning to a community of practice. And the aim behind this, of course, is to ensure greater engagement with stakeholders and multiple agency partners in applying the standards and getting two-way communication, not only in terms of how we can support you better, but also finding out how the standards are really supporting you. And it's really great. So we gave this presentation to the shelter cluster a couple of weeks ago, and we had Miriam Lopez from NRC Iraq, and she said that the shelter cluster had actually applied the construction standards, and it had really informed a lot of the good quality programming that they were undertaking under the shelter cluster activities. So that's the kind of feedback that we really want to hear, particularly if there's improvements that we can make, because we have, in fact, just relaunched a full revision of the standard. The original was launched in 2017, 2018, and based on a lot of evaluation and particularly the sort of greater understanding and awareness and attraction of the environmental concepts and planning, this has been much strengthened in the latest version. We have got our own independent website. It's currently just on a pilot stage, but it is live, where you can find the construction standards, and we'll be uploading a lot of tools specifically linked to work that we've done with standards, you know, examples to get you started. I don't know about the rest of you, but I'm hopeless with a blank sheet of paper and just love seeing if I can steal work from other people. You're welcome to steal away. This stuff will all be open source and free to use. We have developed the Facebook page also to support a more informal community of practice. So you can click on the Global Shelter Cluster Working Group page and follow the group on that website, or also join us on the Facebook page for a more informal, depending on your kind of preference. We know, obviously, some people just love Facebook, others run screaming. So, you know, we're trying to cater to a very broad audience here in terms of engaging on this discussion, knowing the levels of multiple stakeholder engagement that's required. And then also just to give a few examples of some of the interagency and partnership activities that we've seen on this, I mentioned Iraq and the shelter cluster there. We also have some more examples on where this has been embedded into agency practice and manuals. And we also have amazing disaster ready mobile training guide as an introduction to the standards. It's low bandwidth for field use. And really the aim behind this is that we're trying to get this information out of the, you know, computers on Geneva and into the pockets of the engineers in the field. So as much as possible, we're striving to create a dialogue with those guys. And I think the Facebook page will also support us heavily in getting that conversation started. And certainly from my perspective in Save the Children, that's always been a big priority. Many times because these guys are in the field, they're not sitting behind a desk or, you know, downloading PDFs of multiple standards, et cetera. So we're striving to make this information accessible. So where we're seeing great endorsement, the DFID standards from humanitarian guidance note from 2018 on shelter and settlements directly links the construction standards by stating that it is critical for DFID to ensure that partners have robust quality assurance processes in place from the concept stage of construction programs, and these processes are followed throughout. And there they state the compliance of the global shelter cluster should be a requirement. The next two fantastic endorsements, one recently finalized or might still be in approval stage, but very sweetly shared by CRS. They've endorsed the how-to guide within their how-to guide for managing construction. They particularly found that the benchmark for project budgeting really resonated with them and was supporting them in terms of applying a baseline to how much should we be adding in our budget for supervision of construction activities. And there's a very nice direct diagram of how that, you know, 5 to 10% can be calculated based on the risk of the project. Again, Swiss Solidarity, another fabulous support from them in their minimum standards for the reconstruction of buildings for public use. They make reference to a number of standards that should be applied, and they include the good practice standards in that guidance note, which is fantastic. We also seen recently concern in their WASH engineering manual, engineering quality assurance standard operating procedures. I should say that the entire process and stages of a construction project should really take into account all the stages of the good practice benchmark standards. And I've heard from concern that not only has this assisted with their engineers, but it's also been a great support to the finance teams and some of the program support teams in understanding their role in supporting construction implementation. And another one that we've seen is also in NRC's core competency guidance note for the construction of quality education facilities. They make reference to the requirement for good planning around a construction project and have used this diagram from the construction good standards. So really amazing to see how much this is really beginning to support agencies. And as I say, you can see various different standards are informing and supporting where the need is. And we go back to that quotation from the site management minimum standards, camp management minimum standards to state, you know, every agency will find a standard that resonates with them, something that is like a low hanging fruit or perhaps a high risk area that they will seek to endorse and become champions for. And hopefully what we're seeing as a champion activity will soon become mainstream in your activities. And I'm hoping Stacey is online, just to give a shout out to the amazing work that Disaster Ready have been doing in developing these mobile guides to put the information in your pocket. So the first one that we've developed is just an introduction to the standards to give you a really, really brief walkthrough. It's really fabulous with amazing graphics and super interactivity and very low bandwidth. So really it's something that we would seek to really encourage you to share with your field engineers, and also not just engineers, but generally field staff who don't necessarily have access to a lot of training opportunities. Just to say that there will be more coming. We recognize that under each one of the standards, there's probably, you know, a number of training modules that can be developed to support understanding and implementation of them. And so we're looking to seek to improve on that. For example, putting in place another session that directly deals with site safety, lessons that we've learned, et cetera, to how to do a site walkthrough to identify risks, for example. So it's many, many things that we have as an opportunity. I'm sorry, because I know there's all sorts of activity going on in the chat box. We've got like 15, I'm not giving much time for that, but I just wanted to quickly point out, as I said in Save the Children, we've been rolling this out for a long time, and a good example of one of our experiences was with Zimbabwe. We have a methodology for assessing your compliance with benchmark standards, and we're going to be developing one that's particularly linked to the standards for the interagency version. And you score a country office on the basis of 0 to 3, depending on their compliance. So you're not implementing the standard at all, or you're 100%, you know, expert at this. Interestingly, we always see that the procurement procedures, which is standards F, E and F, are very strong, usually because we have a kind of set manual for that and anti-fraud procedures that it means that we are able to apply that. And the places where we always see, you know, in the beginning, that the challenges are around standardized procedures, proposal consultations, and ensuring planning and budgets are you know, consultative. And what we've seen is a massive amount of improvement in Zimbabwe. We still see the staffing is the biggest issue. And again, we come back to that concept of the donors' support. Without that, we will never be able to have the appropriate level of staffing to ensure safe construction activities and accountability by the contractor or even within community-based approaches. We've had amazing response from our Zimbabwe team. And like I say, I've got more than 10 of these that show just incredible performance. Sierra Leone are getting 100%. So a really, really fantastic example of that. And then finally, the future steps. As we mentioned, we'd love to see further adoption by clusters for use in all construction. We'd love to see this endorsed within your camp management standards as a reference to support safe implementation of construction activities. And also, as we've seen, how this can be included into organizational programming by your own agencies. We really are seeking to achieve an overall change in the thinking of when it comes to doing construction in humanitarian contexts. I think that, I mean, you know, I've just segued straight from fire safety into construction standards, but it's the same. You know, we've got to start thinking better about these concepts. So, you know, having the male laborers in gumboots is a kind of now becoming a bit more common standard. But I can tell you the women who are digging the trenches are barefoot and in kikoyas, you know, all the time. And they proudly show me the gumboots that the men are wearing. And I point at the women who are sort of hacking away at the ground with their bare feet sort of exposed to these spades and hoes. And it's really, you know, that we've got a long way to go to really change people's mindsets around these things. And also the support that can come from CCCM generally is ensuring that this document is cross-referenced within the cooperation and coordination aspects of your complementary guides and standards. We've seen our standards embedded into a number of documents. So that's really good news. And also looking at how you can support us to further refine the future revisions based on your feedback. So that's really where we'd like to see us going, and we'd be so grateful for any feedback or engagement from you guys. So as I mentioned, the opportunities to get involved, we have the website. The Disaster Ready Training Module is going to be launched, I want to say Wednesday, but I don't want to put pressure on the Disaster Ready team. But if you go on their website, you can see there's a whole section for the mobile training guides, and you can sign up for updates there. So you'll be able to get the update from them directly to your inbox. Please talk about this and get people thinking. The status quo is not okay. And we know that we have a lot to do in terms of improving construction activities. And as I said, we have a Facebook page, which is called the Construction Good Practice Standards. And yeah, we'd love to see this the standards being applied or referenced in your projects. So that is me. So as I said, there's some critical links there. That's what the Construction Standards Working Group page looks like on the Shelter Cluster website. We have a button that says follow this working group. And if you follow it, we will be able to provide updates and you'll get updates directly to your inbox. And we promise we won't spam you. We're not that active, but we'd really love to be able to broaden our user base and start to get two-way dialogue on how the standards are helping you. Thank you, over from me.
Thank you so much, Liz and Shane. And the chat has really gone off on a whole discussion about standards and about fire safety and now about construction. And it's so interesting to see how it's gone full circle about, you know, kind of participation and involvement of women, kind of back to what we were discussing this morning, Liz, about you're bringing in the topic of women's empowerment. And I like that it's even linked back into kind of informal labor now. And so we will definitely encourage everyone to go to Disaster Ready and look at your training guidance as soon as that's available and online, and look for more ways for us to collaborate together. So thank you so much for such a dynamic presentation, and you surely have captured the audience here.